but Havlicek steals it. Havlicek stole the ball.
Hello, I'm Chris Fowler for Sports Century. When he was about seven, Shaquille O'Neal switched superheroes from the Incredible Hulk to Superman because the S on his new role model's chest matched his own first initial. In a later life, O'Neal put Superman's logo on the headlights of his Mercedes and the front door of his Beverly Hills home. For all his celebrity, the 7-1 Miami center is still searching for recognition, if not love. And who better to identify with than the Ubermensch, who, legend tells us, is faster than a speeding bullet, more powerful than a locomotive. It's a bird. It's a plane. No, wait. It's Shaqman.
If Shaq had his druthers, he would live life in kind of a giant cartoon diorama. He would always be the dominant figure, but there would be other people, and it would be basically a happy life with him in the center of it.
I don't know if being the center of attention is necessarily just about him, but entertaining everybody else, making everybody else laugh.
It is I, Superman, the son of Jor-El.
One day you hear Shaq say, I'm not an All-American. I'm on a team all by myself. I'm all-world, all-universe. The world is mine.
This isn't Michael Jordan who polished his own image for the masses so that he could sell sneakers and soft drinks. Sometimes he's a little bit profane.
We're not worried about the Sacramento Queens.
Shaq, we're on live.
And a lot of times he's just big and goofy.
I love Shaquille O'Neal. If you're around him, you love him. He's a unique personality. Shaquille is like a big puppy dog.
He shows his personality at the right time. He knows the camera's gonna follow him. And he figured that out his rookie year when he just broke out in the middle of the floor and started breakdancing.
You have to understand marketing.
I do everything right. If you don't believe it, make a highlight tape and look at me. Show me going to the community. Show me talking to the little kids. Show me going through the hood by myself. I'm a classy individual.
I think it's taken us a while to figure out who Shaq is. He's definitely come into his own, but it's been on his terms in a way that he wants to have us view him.
Shaq is in your town.
Who dare to wake me?
Is it hot in here, or is it just me?
With a personality as big as his body,
an awesome yet terrifying spectacle all in one,
Shaquille O'Neal relishes his off-court role as the NBA's irrepressible man-child. But when the referee's whistle blows, he settles into a warrior's stoicism, his face impassive, his mind focused. Although O'Neal believes fiercely in the game's oldest, most fundamental offensive strategy, two of his co-stars, Penny Hardaway and Kobe Bryant, didn't buy into the big man theory.
Shaq has always felt that the ball should go through him because he shoots a high percentage and he gets people in foul trouble. Penny believed that his game was the ascendant game and he was the difference maker. And so you had this clash of two very young players who both wanted to be the guy.
After we went to the NBA Finals, Penny really kind of elevated his game, and then people started looking at, well, maybe this should be Penny's team.
And suddenly Penny was making as much or more money than Shaq. It didn't sit well with Shaq. I think that's when he really started looking westward.
Wherever Shaq goes, Shaq is going to be the main focus. And for anyone else to try to exist on that same level with Shaq is going to be tough.
When Kobe emerged as a star, that's when these issues came up about jealousies, rivalries, this and that sort of thing.
When everything went through me, the outcome was good. If the big dog ain't me, then the house won't get guarded, period.
Shaq had this thing of, I'm the big brother, Kobe's the little brother. He didn't do it to belittle Kobe, but I think it did. And Kobe finally said, hey man, I'm the best player in the league. Why am I always the little brother?
By the fall of 1999, the hard feelings had grown to the point where during a pickup game before practice,
Shaq slapped Kobe. The slap was a sign of disrespect.
Was it more Shaq's fault or Kobe's fault? Was it more Shaq's fault or Penny Hardaway's fault? You can have your own opinion on that, but Shaq has his opinion. It was 100% Penny Hardaway's fault and 100% Kobe Bryant's fault.
I don't know if Shaquille O'Neal takes enough responsibility for the bad relationships that existed. There were certainly some things that Shaquille O'Neal could have done better.
For a guy that has the personality and charisma and persona that he has, why would you want to take the back seat when you have so much to offer?
Beneath the Warriors' armor, some see a streak of personal denial driven by a need for approval.
Shaq is both the lovable giant and the pained giant. He loved to have people like him, a big guy who gets moody and gets worried about the way people think about him.
He's very thin-skinned and surprisingly insecure. The slightest little snub, if he didn't win the MVP, or people weren't giving him enough benefit of the doubt, all these things bother him immensely.
He also wants to be the common guy.
People don't believe I buy lotto tickets, but hey, I buy them all the time.
And for a superstar athlete who lives his life under the microscope, it's a little bit impossible.
He doesn't want the burden of being the greatest player of all time. He doesn't want his life to be set up on other people's terms.
Biological father left me in the cold when a few months old. I thought a child was greater than gold, but I guess not. You brought me into this world, but you're not my dad. Mess around with them drugs make my mom's mad.
Shaquille is about 9 years old. His mother brings him into a little small tenement in Newark, and there sits Joe Tony, his biological father. He gives him a story about how he went to Seton Hall, played basketball, got into some trouble. Shaquille realizes how sad and lonely his biological father is, and he never asks to see him again.
In 1972, when Shaquille was less than a year old, Joe Tony was sentenced to federal prison for check forgery. When Shaquille was two, his mother Lucille married Philip Harrison, who soon joined the Army.
I was raised by a drill sergeant. If my bed wasn't made right to where you can flip a quarter, I used to get a whooping for that. But you know, it's a mutual respect there. He knows how far to go, and I know how far to go.
A child psychologist would have a field day with some of Phil Harrison's methods. One day, he basically took a ball, told Shaq to keep his hands down, and hit him right in the face with it. He said, if that doesn't hurt you, nothing will. He believed he was saving Shaquille from a far worse life on the streets.
In the span of 3 years, Shaquille's family lived in two cities in New Jersey, Fort Stewart, Georgia, and Wiesbaden, Germany.
Shaq had this itinerant childhood where he was a military brat, went from school to school, and he was this tall, gangly kid that nobody could quite figure out. He became a target of bullies that were several years older.
He felt a lot of insecurity about his size. He was called Shaquir instead of Shaquille. It wasn't a Charles Atlas thing that he got beat up and he wanted to come back. He was too big.
I was called by the U.S. Army to speak on leadership and teamwork and motivation. I finished my lecture. I turn around. Here's this giant of a man. I said, how long have you been in service, soldier? He says, I'm not in service. Coach Brown, I'm only 13 years old.
He came home once crying that he couldn't trick-or-treat anymore. He would get into arguments because they didn't believe that he was a certain age.
When his stepfather was transferred in 1987 to Fort Sam Houston in San Antonio, Texas, Shaquille enrolled at Cole High School. As a 6'10 junior, shades of O'Neal's future vividly emerged on the basketball court.
In the regional tournament, he slammed one down. About 30 seconds later, he did it again. There were some kids under the basket going to take a charge, and the guy said, oh my gosh, I better get the medics. Somebody's going to get killed.
One day, some kid got into it with him, and he ended up beating him up pretty badly. The kid ended up having an epileptic seizure. Shaquille O'Neal realized his size could hurt people.
During his playing career at Cole, the Cougars went 68-1 and captured the state championship in his senior year. At the 1989 McDonald's High School All-American Game, O'Neal generated interest on and off the court.
He goes up to Dick Vitale and he says, remember my name, Mr. Vitale, but you're going to be calling it one day.
Oh! 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 I can't believe it! I can't believe it! That's a seven-footer! Are you serious?
That was his basketball moment in which he'd arrived on a national scale.
I tell you one thing, this guy can play.
In the fall of 1989, O'Neal began playing for LSU and Taskmaster head coach Dale Brown.
One day you hear Shaq saying LSU stands for Little Shaq University.
After practice, Coach Brown said, I want to tell you something. I want you to listen when I tell you. He said, LSU stands for Louisiana State University.
I think that he respects authority, and I think he wants that authority to mean what it says. When I would say put something down, or curfew's at 12, I meant it. I think he respected that.
I used to get yelled at every day, so I could take it. So I don't have a problem when a coach says, dude, I don't have a problem with that.
O'Neal flourished under Brown, averaging 22 points and 13 rebounds in three seasons with the Tigers. But even as the man among boys passed into college legend, he suffered the inevitable consequences faced by supersized centers.
You would hear coaches saying, hey, don't let him shoot and grab him, beat him. He'd take the beatings and still leave with 30.
When the bully side came out of him and he started being more aggressive and started attacking, people started to tell their coaches, he's too big, he's too strong, he's too fast, he jumps too high. What do you want us to do?
I didn't have to watch the Academy Awards in Hollywood. I saw him on the basketball court. A referee or two making the comment to him, oh, just be quiet and play, you're big.
He came to a balling point at the SEC tournament in Birmingham. Got the ball inside the Shaq, the guy just wrapped Shaq up. Shaq slung the guy off him. Both benches cleared.
You see Dale Brown push Groves, and then Groves swings right back at Dale Brown.
That was the turning point when Shaq decided that he was going to go to the league. He said, if I'm going to get beat like this, I'm going to get paid for it.
With the first pick in the 1992 NBA draft, the Orlando Magic selects Shaquille O'Neal from Louisiana State University.
We knew right then that we had something, and that was hope that we could win every game moving forward. Clearly, our new identity was going to be wrapped around the name Shaquille O'Neal.
The popularity of the team multiplied. They couldn't go through airports. He was too popular. There was too much of a commotion.
Team, may I please have an autograph, please?
Pull into a hotel at 2 o'clock in the morning, and there are just hundreds of people waiting outside your hotel. You know, hey, you play with Shaquille O'Neal. Can you get me Shaq's autograph?
His irrepressible charm, his big smile, his skill got around sort of a rule that the big guy is never the popular guy.
When he did the NBA spread, when it was him, Russell, Bill Walton, Chamberlain, all the great center, Jabbar, he was so flabbergasted, wow, they're putting me on a level with these guys already and I haven't even won a ring yet. I really am going to be somebody.
Emerging onto the NBA floor in 1992, like Sinbad in shorts, O'Neal averaged 23 points and won Rookie of the Year honors and the hearts of children everywhere. In 1995, he captured the scoring title by averaging 29 points and led Orlando to the Eastern Conference title. But in the finals, he faced the Rockets, who had their own colossus, Hakeem Olajuwon.
The Houston Rockets have swept the Orlando Magic.
When he came into the league, he went right at Patrick Ewing, right at David Robinson. He had great success against Hakeem in the regular season, but perhaps in the playoffs, maybe he did show him a little bit too much respect.
You just didn't get that sense that he had that focus to be an NBA champion.
You put all that talent together with no maturity, it creates problems.
In 1996, a rift developed between O'Neal and the Magic. After attending his grandmother's funeral in New Jersey, he was seen partying in Atlanta that same evening. The next day, he showed up late for a nationally televised game against the Bulls.
The Sunday game was starting and Shaq was not there yet. NBC asked him what's up with Shaquille, and they just hung him out there like, we don't know where he is.
With a sense of drama, Shaquille O'Neal just arrived at the arena.
I was told several minutes before the opening tap that Shaquille was in the building. My comment was, I'm not sure whether I'll play him or not.
We as players, we didn't think nothing of it. We lose that game, he gets dressed and he storms out of there. Later on that night, we go for a ride, and that's when he tells me, if I leave, this is why I'm leaving.
He started hearing from his agent, if you want to make it to the next step, if you want to win the NBA Finals, then maybe Brian Hill's not the coach for you.
Shaq still wanting to do movies, still wanting to do rap music. Boy, what better place than L.A.? It was pretty much an easy sell.
When Shaq went to L.A., people were just stunned. It was probably the most devastating free agent defection in the history of sports.
It was a long, tedious negotiation. But our owner wanted to build a team.
that would have a chance to win a championship every year.
In July of 1996, O'Neal signed a 7-year contract worth $120 million to play for the Lakers. Visions of Showtime 2 danced throughout the City of Angels.
When he came to Los Angeles, people expected the Lakers to win immediately and for Shaq to be the person responsible for that.
We had had to break up a good part of that young team to make room for him in the salary cap. And at the same time, along with him came Kobe Bryant.
He was young. I was very, very young. And we just kind of grew up together. I mean, we had our bumps along the way. We both wanted to get to the same place, but we just didn't know how to get there together.
San Antonio sweeps and moves on. What does the future hold for the Lakers?
When the Lakers failed to make the NBA Finals over the next three seasons, O'Neal, who had averaged 27 points, caught most of the flack.
Shaquille got beat up, and he's a loser. He doesn't make anybody else better. He's just a big guy drawing a salary.
They thought, you know what, you should be playing basketball 24 hours a day, young man, because you still have not won a championship yet. You should dedicate your life to the game.
Some people say I've got too much on my mind. Movies, music, toys.
A lot of times I got smashed. He's not concentrating. He's in movies. And my thing was, hey, Kareem did movies. Bill Russell did movies. How come I can't do movies?
Shaquille O'Neal is the greatest physical specimen to ever play the game. He could completely dominate if he would work a little bit more on basic fundamental skills.
He's missed 10 consecutive free throws.
But he doesn't feel it's necessary.
I've won on every level except college and on the NBA level, so.
He made that misfortunate quote, but that was really starting to brand him. Every year that went by, his legacy was becoming the answer to a joke.
This is a team that is talented, it's young, it's on the verge.
In June of 1999, the Lakers hired a new head coach, Phil Jackson, who won 6 NBA championships with Chicago and Michael Jordan.
When Phil first got there, he was just trying to explain stuff to Shaq, and it wasn't getting through, so he had to yell at Shaq.
If you see your general stand strong, then you're going to stand strong. My father was a drill sergeant. He used to drill me every day. When I left him, I went to Coach Dale Brown, who did the same thing. I really got it when I met Phil.
I felt like Shaquille was not ever playing up to the level that he had reached in 94. Had some injuries. I thought that he was sitting there waiting to have his game activated.
Go ahead and either rob a Rick side, go corner, go directly into Shaq.
Where Phil Jackson truly succeeded with Shaq was not so much in getting him to play a different game, but in getting him to focus on his game.
In the 1999-2000 season, the underachieving center played with magnum force, averaging 14 rebounds and a league-best 30 points, good enough for the MVP. Even more important, Jackson, the Zen master, seemed to have created a current of positive energy between his two distant stars, O'Neal and Kobe Bryant.
One of the defining moments of that season ended up being in Game 7 of the Western Conference Finals, where they're making this incredible comeback from 15 down. In the midst of that run, Kobe dribbles up toward the top of the key, pulls up to what we think is going to be a jump shot.
And I grabbed it and I was up real high, and I dunked it. You see me pointing up to my wife and my son. He knows I'm Superman and he thinks I can really fly.
Kobe's down the middle, he's in deep, throws the shot, slam dunk! The Lakers lead by 6.
The alley-oop at the end just symbolized where they had come. Kobe could have taken that shot, but he saw the corner of his eye. Shaquille had a better shot if he could just get the ball to him.
They have achieved something here on their own floor that seemed impossible.
After defeating the Trailblazers, the Lakers beat the Pacers in 6 games to win their first NBA championship in 12 seasons. O'Neal scored at least 40 points 3 times against Indiana.
He's won the championship, and he has won the admiration of the basketball world. Look at the tears running down his cheeks.
That was absolutely the most emotional that I had ever seen Shaquille O'Neal. He was almost in a daze.
Thrilled me to death to be there for that first NBA championship. They said you couldn't do it. Now the monkey's off your back.
The MVP of the regular season, the MVP of the All-Star game, and the MVP of the finals, Shaquille O'Neal.
For Shaq, it put a lot of things to rest. A lot of the critics that may have said he'd never won at any level. That's something I think that took a big burden off of him.
No sooner had they won that championship and set off to have another season, Shaq was not in shape, he got into injuries. Kobe's ambition took over, and all of those problems came back. and threatened to rupture every relationship on that team.
His injuries healed, O'Neal joined Bryant, and despite their fractured relationship, they managed to play well enough together to win two more championships.
Can you dig it?
But in 2003, a toe injury hampered O'Neal through most of the campaign as the Lakers failed to reach the conference finals. The next season, renewed acrimony between O'Neal and Bryant was publicly played out like a soap opera.
I don't give a shit who scores the most points. I don't give a shit who's getting the most media attention.
He said what he said, I said what I said, we put it behind us, we move on.
Infighting, injuries, and inconsistency all foretold the death of a dynasty.
But the Detroit Pistons have just shocked the Los Angeles Lakers.
3 days after being upset in five games by the Pistons in the finals, Phil Jackson was told by the Lakers owner, Jerry Buss, his contract would not be renewed.
The moment Phil Jackson was not retained, Shaquille knew that his days in Los Angeles were numbered.
What sets Phil Jackson apart from other coaches is his consistency. Nothing fazes him. When they got rid of Phil, I was very upset, and I knew that they were going to start making changes. Changes that I didn't want to be a part of.
He felt that Kobe Bryant was behind closed doors just pulling strings to get rid of everybody.
The Lakers organization made a commitment to Kobe Bryant, and Shaq felt that. He understood that. So right then, you know, he wanted to go. He wanted to go somewhere where he was going to be appreciated and respected.
Shaq has a need to be liked, and he needed a new place to be the new popular kid in class.
After 12 NBA seasons in which he averaged 27 points and 12 rebounds, O'Neal was traded to Miami in July of 2004. One of his early public statements to Heat fans amounted to a solemn promise. There would be no repeat of the Kobe Wars.
I'm letting you know now it's Dwayne Wade's team. He's that type of guard that could lead us and do good things. And I'm just his big brother, and I'm just here to back him up.
With Kobe, it was more like that little brother that would annoy it. With Dwayne Wade, it's that little brother that Shaq's proud of, that he wants to be out there and let everybody see, this is my little brother, look what he's doing.
Winning one with Dwayne Wade will prove, especially in his mind, that he was never the problem in LA.
With three NBA championship rings and as many finals MVP awards, O'Neal's legacy is already secure in the eyes of his peers.
Shaq is the greatest center of his time. He's proven that. It took him a while to get to the top, but he worked hard and got to the top and stayed there, and that's a testimony to his greatness.
He has his size and his stature, but he still can handle the ball. He still can reverse layup. You know, he still can jump hook. He understands the game, which is most impressive to me, at his size, where he doesn't really have to.
In 25 years, I don't think there'd be any more players my size. I think they'll be tall, but I don't think they'll be this big, this sexy, this defined. I'm the last of my breed.
On December 26, 2002, Shaquille O'Neal married Shawnee Nelson, who was pregnant with their third child. The following Valentine's Day, in an exclusive Beverly Hills restaurant, he donned an apron and a chef's hat emblazoned with Chef O'Neal and cooked a six-course dinner in honor of his new bride. The fare included Alaskan king crab legs, ribeye steak, roasted lamb, and chicken. Shaq signed autographs and posed for a picture with the staff. Just another intimate supper with the man who would be king. For Sports Century, I'm Chris Fowler.